dear colleagues and friends. Within the next minutes, I will speak about postnatal balancing and bridging, because prenatally, all AV channels are functionally balanced, but what happens after birth? Which patients are at risk and might profit from balancing? And what are the tools for balancing and bridging? Start with the question, which patient is at risk and might profit from balancing? When we look at the SDS database, we see data from 2,400 patients with AV channel from 101 centers in the US. 78% had Down syndrome. Median age at surgery was almost 5 months, but 12% below 2.5 months. Median weight at surgery, 5 kilo. They had additional pulmonary artery bending removal in 4.6%. Major complication rate of 9.8%, including a permanent pacemaker in 2.7. Length of stay is always in the US very short, 8 days. And hospital mortality, 3%. So these are excellent results. We should send our kids to surgery, and there's no need for balancing postnatally. But to look deeper into the data, one should look who is on special risk and might benefit from waiting and medical therapy for balancing. Here you see that there is a discharge mortality which differs very much by weight at surgery. Those children below 3.5 kilo at the surgical procedure, they have an enormous risk to die, up to 15-18%, whereas those kids which are had a higher weight, they have only death mortality risk below 3%. So death mortality by weight at surgery is one point, and the other is age at surgery. From this database, children with a younger age than 2.5 months had a much higher risk, mortality of 9.5%, whereas the older ones, 2.1%. And then look at the Down syndrome. Down syndrome is somehow protective. It is not significant, but the trend, death in Down syndrome children was lower, and it was significant that the complication rate in children with Down syndrome was lower than in those without Down. So infants below 3.5 kilo or below 2.5 months might benefit from weighting and balancing. But back, one step back, what happens after birth? Abraham Rudolph, I really like his papers, for example, this in Circulation from 1970. In the 60s, he worked on the fetal change from fetal life to birth, and he very nicely describes that the decrease in pulmonary vascular resistance after birth will favor the flow through the lungs versus the systemic circulation, and an increase in pulmonary venous return to the left atrium and ventricle will result with an increased diastolic volume in the ventricle and on the basis of the Frank-Starling mechanism, in an increase in left ventricular stroke volume. He looked at the comparison of fetal and postnatal course on normal births and on high altitude births and on those with a ventricular septal defect. And in all of the parameters, pulmonary vascular resistance, blood flow and pulmonary arterial pressure and thickness of the pulmonary arteries, there was no difference before birth, but afterwards there was a fall in pulmonary vascular resistance much more slowly in the VSD patient. The blood flow increases in the pulmonary blood flow as the pulmonary vascular resistance falls. And here in the last graph, the muscle in the pulmonary arteries does not regress as rapidly as in normal infants. And there is the course up to 5 weeks after birth. He also opened a large artificial autopulmonary shunt in a one-day-old calf and in an adult dog. And in the one-day-old calf, there was almost no effect, just a very small increase in LV stroke volume and a very small decrease in aortic pressure. But in adult dog, there was a huge effect with a large increase in stroke volume and LA pressure with a marked fall in LV systolic pressure. So, what are the tools for balancing and bridging for our small children on risk beyond week 3, 4, 5? Postnatal balancing and bridging ends in, or otherwise, other round. The heart failure symptoms in our children with an AV channel occur at week 3, 4, 5. And heart failure symptoms become obvious, and heart failure is associated with neurohumoral activation and increased levels of circulating neurohormones like adrenaline, noradrenaline, renin, angiotensin II, aldosterone, and so on. And this is leading to vasoconstriction, sodium water retention, and is followed by myocardiocytes, apoptosis, necrosis, and fibrosis. So the signs of acute decompensated heart failure in our babies before surgery, if they are warm and dry, it's no congestion and no severe low perfusion syndrome. If they are cold and wet, they are in need for intensive care. If they have a congestion and they are warm and wet, they have signs of hepatomegaly, tachypneu, autopneu, or maybe ascites. If they have a low perfusion, and they might be cold and dry, they have signs of hypotension or tachycardia, cold extremities, and these need medical treatment. Of course, you should have a complete labor assessment like electrolytes, blood gas analysis, renal and liver and thyroid hormones, and of course a complete blood count. First of all, you should exclude additional conditions like aortic stenosis or coarctation or things which are very rare like mid-aortic syndrome, all the things which elevate the systemic resistance. Then you should think about how to reduce systemic vascular resistance. And one very easy thing is keep the baby warm. Keep it in the incubator or with radiant teeter. And for the first choice for medical treatment in this cases, we start with Myrinone IV. We don't use levosimendan because there's an additional pulmonary vascular resistance decrease. But Myrinone, I think, is in these kids with heart failure symptoms a well-known and good acting drug. Then we switch to ACE inhibitors, and it is important to tell all your nurses and all your colleagues that you should have these kids in with room air and with no additional oxygen, even to accept in the newborns saturations down to 75 or 80. And it's really good to have a PO2 between 50 and 60 in regard of pulmonary vascular resistance. Maybe mild sedation. Well, when I started with pediatric cardiology, this was luminal, lanoxine, and what was the third L? we changed these. Lasix, yeah. So we were complete away from this system, but you should teach everybody maybe mild sedation because the kids should not hyperventilate, they should not have pain or stress, and this also means be careful with blood punctures and pain. Tube feeding, add 45 calories enough, and then maybe spironolactone, maybe hydrochlorothiazide, and you should avoid longer terms of catecholamines, and you should avoid long terms of loop diuretics. There are 33, 7 infants recently described with congenital heart disease and left-right shunt, age 3 months. And this group from Turkey wanted to see whether enalapril, furosemide, and digoxin in group A is preferable compared to group 2 with enalapril and furosemide alone. And they did not go for survival, but they had NT-proBNP levels and assessed the NT-proBNP levels and compared the ROS scoring and the BNP. And in both groups, they found a very nice decrease of BNP from 13,000 to 3,000, but there was, and also a decrease in ROS score, but there was no additional benefit from digoxin between the groups. So in our clinic, we very rarely use digoxin and only for heart rate control and not for myocardial improvement of myocardial function. So what's about beta blocker? All pediatric beta blockers trials failed to prove efficacy, and the parents are very concerned about potential side effects. But all our pediatric trials were highly underpowered. You need more than 400 patients with mild to moderate heart failure to find a clinical benefit, and you need at least 3,000 patients to prove signs of mortality benefit. So the sicker the children, the lower the rate you need for your clinical trials. And here, Rainer Buchhorn very nicely had this beta blocker comparison. Here you have the adult patients with a high number, up to 10,000 patients in this study, the COMET, CBIS, MERIT, Copernicus, I think you all know them from the 10 years ago. But for mortality outcome, you need several thousand patients, even in the adults. And when you look for clinical outcome, then you need a little less, but also more than a few hundred. And here is the last group. These are our pediatric trials. And the biggest one is the US carvedilol trial from Daphne Su and Rob Shetty. And they had really hard time to include 161 patients. And we were all very disappointed that the outcome was negative. But on the other hand, all of our adult COMET, CBIS, and so on would have been negative result if they only had this patient number included. So I think you know MERIT study, metoprolol randomized as a beta blocker versus placebo, almost 4,000 patients. CBIS 2, it was 2,500 patients. Copernicus, this was the carvedilol trial of the adults, which was stopped after 10 months because the reduction of 35% risk reduction regarding death. And these high numbers, we will never make these high numbers, but I show you a new drug, which is in adult medicine for the last few months accepted. This is called Enestu, Sacubitril and Valsartan in a combination, which is an angiotensin-neprilysin inhibitor, ARNI, and an AT1 receptor blocker. And this works with in the enhancing of vasorelaxation, which decreases fibrosis, decreases hypertrophy, and increases natriuresis. And on the other hand, over the RAS pathway, it inhibits the vasoconstriction, and it increases blood pressure, it increases it stops the sympathetic tone and decreases fibrosis. So in this study, this Paradigm HF study, they included 8,300 patients. And here are the results. Number needed to treat in adults is 32 to prevent one cardiovascular death. And now we started a study with this, Ernesto, with this combined therapy. This pediatric trial will start, I think first patient in will be in end of this year. And it is a multi-center trial from 3 continents. And we will include several hundred, hopefully several hundred patients. And Nevertheless, I don't believe that we will show mortality outcomes difference, but I think our need is to, or our duty is to show PK and PD, pharmacokinetic and pharmacodynamic, in our patients, and we should show that they have no severe side effects, so safety. This is an old slide from Stephanie Lehr. She showed that PK/PD in carvedilol is very different in a one-year-old patient compared to a 17-year-old patient. The one-year-olds, or the smaller ones, need a much higher amount of drug to get the same blood level, and I think also to get an effect. And so the half-life time in patients between 0 and 3 years is about half of those in older children and in adults. So I think these are our duties to learn how is the dosing and which substance is safe for our children. And then I think we should treat our patients who are on special risk for heart failure with an AV channel, those who are below 3.5 kilo or below 2.5 months, we should treat them if they are symptomatic, if they don't grow, and if they don't breathe quietly, with ACE inhibitors, with beta blockers, with aldosterone antagonists. If necessary, for short term, with pulsed diuretic. But we should not wait until intractable symptoms occur, and we should not put them on mechanical assist device or on ECLS. But I think also if they are high-risk children, we should send them to surgery for AVSD and don't wait for intractable symptoms. One very last thought about pulmonary artery bending. The role of pulmonary artery bending is, well, it changed a lot during the last 20 years. Majority of AV channels were banded in the 20, 25 years ago. But when you look at the ERCTS or the STS database, PA banding is not a low-risk procedure, especially in AV channels with a high regurgitation of the AV valve. Hospital mortality from ERCTS database was 8.6%, and in mortality rate in the STS database, 13%, although these are small numbers. What's the timing for banding? The group from Richard Jonas could show that you don't need to wait until the pulmonary vascular resistance is down, very low, but he looked at retrospectively his charts and 54 patients with pulmonary banding at the age of median 18 days, early mortality 4%, and reoperation for readjustment was 7%. So I would recommend that younger age at the time of banding was not associated with a mortality of higher risk of mortality or reoperation. And in those cases where medical treatment failed and the kids are not suitable for heart lung machine and correction, there might be still an option for pulmonary artery banding. And there are four papers which compare the conventional banding versus the adjustable banding. And I can conclude, I think the time is going on, that in all of these four trials, although they are not randomized prospective trials, they show a reduction in early deaths, reduction in ventilatory times, and a reduction in need for inotropes and further intervention in those patients who had an adjustable banding. And I think in this might be, our industry should put on more effort to work on these tools for the near future, I think, because in other technical aspects, this if there would have been more money in this idea, it would not be so difficult. To give a word of caution, the Liverpool group wrote an abstract and reported about 56 pulmonary artery bendings with FlowWatch, and they had 13% deaths, 6 late, and 33% PA distortion, which needed patch enlargement at the time of surgery, of corrective surgery, and 7% erosions of the bending through the mean pulmonary artery. To conclude, the patients at risk are those with unbalanced ventricles, associated lesions, and clinical conditions like infection, chronic lung disease, or non-cardiac malformation, and those with a small body weight and young age. And tools for balancing and bridging are bending and medical therapy with beta blockers, ACE inhibitors, aldosterone inhibitors, and so on. And we should not withhold therapies which prove to be effective in adult heart failure, because we know that the neurohormonal activation seems to be very similar in children and in adults. But nevertheless, pediatric PK/PD studies should be performed, and this is our duty for the next years. Thank you very much.